Hello my friends, welcome again to my video channel. Today we will continue the project repair and restoration of this Multi 2000. This project is a little bit longer than I've expected. I told you at the end of part two. Today we will continue with the alignment of the SSB part where we have instabilities of the S meter. I have some ideas. It is a pending topic which is not so easy to repair. I have some ideas what the cause of the problem is, but I have to prove it and then to solve it. One topic is back. You remember we had the problem that the mode SSB, the S meter, indicated a rather high input signal without signal. This level dropped when I removed the preamp, which is not necessary, and when I connected the two relays, including the coupling capacitors or decoupling capacitors, filter capacitors to ground. You remember it was pinched off, but it didn't cure the problem perfect. Now I found the reason for the rest of this problem. It is a so-called BFO leakage. What's this? Well, an SSB receiver has a BFO to generate an audible tone, CW or SSB. This BFO is for the demodulation, but it shouldn't reach the IF stages. When it comes into the IF stages, there's a danger that this carrier, it is a carrier, constant carrier, that this BFO carrier is also amplified by the IF, and then we have an S meter deflection. The signal cannot be heard because it's a zero beat. When a part of this BFO gets into the demodulator and a small part into the IF amplifier, then in the demodulator the signal is mixed by itself and the result is zero. Cannot be heard, but we have an S meter indication, and that was a problem here. Let's have a look at the schematic. Here we have the receive path, the SSB signal 16.9 MHz, is that the IF comes in, goes to this amplifier, and via this diode here, it goes through the filter. This is a balanced modulator for the TX. But this is a diode which switches on in TX, but here we have a diode for RX. And then it goes here through the IF stages, is amplified. This is the AGC. And here we have the demodulator, four diodes. And these four diodes get a signal for demodulating via this connection, this, and this. From here, 16.895 MHz, that's a BFO. It's a little bit below the receive, then the IF for upper sideband. The problem is now that this BFO signal also gets to the TX modulator. It is not interrupted here. This amplifier, the audio frequency amplifier, is switched off in RX mode. It's only in TX mode switched on here. But the BFO also gets through this modulator and this diode into the receive channel. This diode, of course, is switched off. But there's always a small coupling over these diodes when there's a signal which is strong enough, so it can be seen, because these three amplifiers here are rather sensitive. And this was a problem. The modulator here wasn't balanced. I readjusted this VR2. It's a balancing for this for the four diodes, this ring mixer, and also a little bit this cap is C1. I think we can hardly see it, but it's a standard schematic R and C. When I balanced it perfectly as it should, in mode receive of course, then this BFO leakage was gone, and then the S meter drops down to zero. It's a little bit touchy here at this part, but it can be aligned, so this problem is solved now. The pot which I had to realign is this pot here. There are the four diodes. We can see them This is a pot, the balancing pot, 1, 2, 3, 4 diodes. And this has to be set to zero BFO output, and the S meter deflection then goes down to zero, then we have no problems. Next step will be checking and aligning the FM demodulation. There's some problem with the linearity, bad sound, so I'm not sure whether it's set okay. The FM part here is this, a little bit higher, one moment. This part here, this is the input for the 16.9 megahertz amplification, ceramic filter, another filter here, and this is a discriminator, and here anyway is the output to the AF stage. I've connected a small scope, my small bench scope, this one, to the output of the loudspeaker. It is here above. And then I can align this discriminator for best signal. This one I think is for maximum, and this one also for maximum at low amplitude. The problem is how to couple a 16.9 megahertz signal into it. Well, I have here some homemade probes. It's a small coil, some inductivities, coax cable, 50 ohm, connected to the output of my signal generator, and I bring it in close vicinity of the amplifier, for example. The signal is set to 16.9 megahertz, and this is FM modulated, 1 kilohertz and 3 kilohertz deviation. And you see here, when I bring it into the vicinity, then I have here a signal. And the next step is very simple. I have to adjust the discriminator for best signal at the center frequency. And you can see it's a little bit touchy. And the next problem is the center frequency is not exactly 16.9000. It's a little bit more up. It's approximately 1 kilohertz up, and then the sine wave gets a little bit better. But I leave it, doesn't matter. And here I can increase, hopefully, but I have to decrease the signal strength. Okay, a little bit noisy. No reaction. Doesn't matter. I leave it as it is. This one I will tune when I have an input signal, because the coupling is behind this filter. Okay. That's it, and now I will align the S meter and the FM center. It's a little bit of a compromise to get the best alignment, because the filter center frequency seems to be approximately 800 or 900 hertz above 16.9 kilohertz. So the frequency center indication is not identical. When I remove the signal, we have now a signal. When I take the 16.9 away, then we have only noise, and the noise indication is a little bit higher. When I couple it again, it's lower, a little bit, not very much. So I will try to adjust this pot, which gives us the setting, the center setting of the frequency deviation to zero. This is, here we have it. This is with signal 16.9000, and when we are off frequency, we have a little bit a slight difference, but this doesn't matter. Most important is that we have the correct indication when there's an input signal. Then it's okay. Smith and now is a little bit negative. That's also okay. Well, FM part is now aligned. Center frequency also, and we have, just to show it, full deflection when I go some kilohertz up and down. We can see that this centimeter goes up and down. One moment. 16.9902. So we're 2.2. Three kilohertz, four, 5 kilohertz above. And here we are, rather exactly 5 kilohertz below. Oops, we lost the signal. So we can say it's centered. It's a never-ending story. I still have problems with the stability of the S-meter in single sideband. You remember, I adjusted this pot here. It's a balancing pot for the SSB modulator to reduce the deflection and to nearly null out the BFO leakage. But when I switch the transceiver off, switch it on again, or when I use transmit RX switching with a microphone, PTT, sometimes the instability appears again, or it disappears, and so on and so on. First step now is I replace this old pot here by a new one. This old pot was obviously a little bit crispy. It has seen better days, but okay. Cured the problem. But not completely. But I've observed when I touch this region here with my hand, when I have an S meter deflection without received signal, and when I lay my hand over it and bring my fingers into it, or when I use such a metal sheet and ground it here, then the S meter deflection goes down to zero. So obviously we need some shielding. I'm not sure what it means, but here, whether you can see it, here's a dotted line from here to here to here to here. Does it mean that there has to be a shielding? Maybe, but there are no holes in the PCB to solder this shielding to the ground layer. I don't know exactly, but I will use such a shield with some wires. So I use it like a roof, bring it as close as possible to the components here and make a shielding. Maybe I use it in this way so that this side here also makes a little bit of a shielding. I will try it, whether it helps. I'm quite sure it helps, because it's a rather open circuit here and the capacitive coupling is obviously too high. When I checked it, I've seen that someone has made a modification here. You see these two resistors, trim pots, they are in the emitters of the two transistors, which are the IF amplifications. We have 1, 2, and 3 transistors, which are the amplifiers, and this is a negative feedback resistor, which reduces the gain. It shouldn't be set down to zero because the amplification is too high, so it's advisable to use 5 or 10 ohms. The pots have totally 250 ohms, so if it's set to be maybe 10 or 20 ohms or so, this is a little bit higher. The gain here can be reduced. This also reduces this effect of the instable S meter, but it doesn't clean it completely. I realign these three filters to maximum. Then I would have to reduce the gain, but this is better to be spot on the frequency with these three filters and reduce the gain here instead of increasing the gain of the transistors and detuning the filters. That's not a good solution. Again, I will make here a solution for the additional metal shield I will drill here some holes in it, 1, 2, 3, maybe a fourth one. Feed some thick wire through it, solder them on the bottom side of the PCB, and then put the shield on it to improve it. Before I drill, I have to check the bottom side that I don't damage anything when I go from this side through the PCB, not to damage any wire or coax cable. So the first hole is here where the trim capacitor is. It's here, that's okay. So I can drill the first hole. Second hole is this is the resistor here. That's also okay. Then I drill it here. Here and here is very good. Next one should be in this region. Here's the ground connection. Yes, it's okay. Also very good. And the fourth one, I should look here for the ground. Yes, I think here's the best area. Yes, it's ready now. Four holes. 1, 2, 3, 4. Now I look for a wire which I can feed through and solder it on this side, and then I cut this metal sheet into the appropriate size and install it. Before support wires, I've chosen a wire with 1.2 millimeter diameter. It's rather stiff. Are in place, soldered here, 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 and here. I scratched off the enamel a little bit. Now I can install the cover, the shield. Hopefully that's the solution of this problem. This is the first test. Now I can cut this metal sheet into the right shape. Here, 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 here. Squeeze it down, solder it, and pinch off the not needed wires. This should be okay. I have only to consider that I have still access to the trim pot here inside, to this one for the setting of the carrier balance and modulation. It is also a pot, but that's rather easy. That's outside, so I can have access to it. The shielding is in place now. I soldered these four wires through the hose. I didn't bend them, so it's rather easy to remove the shield. Only remove the solder here with a desoldering pump or a vacuum pump or so. Then you can take off the shield if necessary, do any repairs, and then bring it back. Well, I hope it's now solved. I will of course observe this S-meter very carefully, but with the first check it seems okay now. The alignment of the filters here for the IF section. These filters here is very touchy. Also the alignment of the pots. The gain shouldn't be too high. It's always a good idea to reduce the gain, to tune these cores, of course, for maximum, and then reduce again with the two pots here to avoid any self oscillations or too much noise. And so the receiver is rather sensitive. I've set a signal 0.15 microvolt. You can hear it. This is 0.15 microvolt. Should be, I don't have the data in my head. But this is very sensitive, and there is no need for a further preamplifier within the receiver. At the antenna, there's another question. After the installation of this little shield here, by the way, you may ask how this shield works, because it seems to be rather open. Yes and no. Consider the frequency here at this point is 16.9 megahertz. That's a wavelength of a little bit less than 20 meters. So such a shield is a rather good shield, because the capacitive field which is generated on this PCB here is connected via this shield here to ground. Of course, there are some holes around it. It's not a perfect shield, but for low frequencies, when 16.9 megahertz is a low frequency, it helps. It's good enough. Of course, it's not perfect. This is not a shield for any gigahertz wave in the centimeter range, of course. But for this purpose, it is sufficient. As we have seen, it makes the performance better. Of course, it could be improved, but I would have to do too much modification also on the PCB here. Relocate some components, because I cannot install a shield here. It would be difficult, so I think it's an acceptable compromise. Well, I've tweaked these settings of the IF chain here, also here. This is the transformer for the transmit mode, but this is for reception, filter reception here, and here's a demodulator. So I should again realign these filters for maximum. I reduced the gain considerably with these pots here. It's a problem. I don't know where this modification was made. I assume it was made in the factory. Anyhow, it's rather simple. I have an infeed of a signal with approximately 1 microvolt, a small S-meter deflection. When I detune it, you can see it. It goes down to zero. Nothing heard. Still, the pot is a little bit crispy here. And then I can adjust this S-meter here to maximum deflection. I've done it already, just show you the effect. Okay, a little bit. Here we have also a little bit to improve. And so on, also with these coils here. These two are interacting, we have to be careful. Okay, I go down to 0.3 microvolt. No deflection of the S meter. Okay, if the signal is too low, we should have a signal to noise ratio of 10 dB. Can be, yes. Additionally, there is a pot for the AF output of the behind the SSB demodulator. I leave it as it is, because the noise of the FM and the SSB signal is approximately the same. Here we have a pot which sets the threshold of the AGZ line. It is set to the moment where the AGZ just starts to act and to reduce the level at very, very low input signals. I did it. So the SSB part here is aligned. I also aligned the inputs part here and here and here. For SSB, the FM alignment we did already. So I think the receive part here is now okay. And then we can go to the transmit path. When the alignment of such coils is done, it's always a good idea to fix them with a drop of wax. It's rather easy. I take a wax, bee wax, wax from bees, place a little piece above it, and then I take a very small and cheap soldering iron. It has a nominal power of 12 volt 8 watts, and I operate it with 8 or 9 volts, so it doesn't get too hot. It's just warm enough to melt the beeswax. That's it. Same with the other cores. If there is still existing beeswax like here, it's only necessary to remelt it again and to seal it again. I do not have to add a new one. Don't use too much wax. Consider that maybe you have to remove it in the future. And then you have problems when you use too much. Only as much as what is needed to fix it. To fix the core here and here. Also here, this part also is aligned. It's the FM part. And so on and so on. First, I will check the frequencies for FM modulation. With and without repeater shift. I go to the synthesizer, radio is set to 145.600, receive frequency and transmit. And we can see it here on the display, 145.599999. It can be set with a VXO aligned. That's it. The VXO is a little bit okay. We can set it. And now we go to duplex. That means 600 kilohertz below, 144.9999. We are approximately, it should be 145.000. We are approximately 500 hertz below. There are two crystals here in the transceiver. These are these two crystals for transmit with and without 16.9 and 16.3. So I will realign that 16.3 kilohertz crystal a little bit to get exactly 600 kilohertz shift. I will do it. I look for a tool which is perfect for this purpose. I hope it's a good one for this purpose. That's a disadvantage of a turntable. I will align it. I And now without duplex. Nine, 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 nine. Okay. Now with duplex. Okay. 10 hertz off. Yes. That's okay. Accurate enough. No more action needed. In general, as I see, the TX path is in the original calibration. I didn't see any tampering or so. The wax, if existing, is in the original state, so nobody tampered here. This is maybe only a drift with the age. The rest is here. I will look for it. The most important thing is what I have to do is in transmit mode, in SSB mode, to readjust the carrier suppression in single sideband mode. The counter check in receive mode. I've set my signal generator to 145.600. You see we have an error of 110 hertz, plus minus 10 hertz, it's not relevant. And now I connect this output from the generator to the input of the transceiver. I have to reduce the signal a little bit because I increased it for the counter. And then we can see here on the frequency meter, the center indication, we are spot on frequency. That means when we receive, for example, a repeater station on 145.600, it's sufficient to center it with the VXO exactly on frequency, spot on. And then we have the required output frequency, what we need. I wanted to check the modulation for FM and SSB. When I use an internal test generator, I'm in mode SSB, high power, and I have a rather full deflection, nearly 10 watts. Low power, of course, less. But when I use the microphone here, it is dead, nothing comes out. When I connect, instead of the microphone here, with this simple adapter, my tone generator, two signals in and connect the other two ones. This is a PTT contact. I also have output low power and high power, no problem. So I think there's something wrong with the microphone. I have to open it and look what happens. I think the reason was found very quickly. The problem was the wire of the microphone was broken here. This is a screen. The screen is okay, I only desoldered it. But here the wire was broken. The reason is this plug here has a screw, you know it. This screw is to fix this plastic part in the plug to avoid that it slips out, and this screw was missing. So it was loose and with every movement of the cable, the mechanical stress came over this wire to this pin here. It was obviously the shortest one, and this broke off. So I will squeeze it in a little bit, secure it with the braid. Maybe I will make it a little bit longer. I will see to find a solution. I have resoldered the plug. Now it's a good opportunity to check the contact, the PTT contact here, and to clean it a little bit. And it's, I can say it is necessary, as we see. There's also some dirt coming out. Yes, these contacts also are very thankful to see some drops of contact cleaner. Yes, and now the other side. And the same procedure again. still some dirt. But now it gets cleaner. Okay. Luckily I found a new screw to secure this plug in one of my boxes here. I'm collecting all screws I get. Don't throw them away when I don't need them from my old equipment and so on. And there was one screw which maybe came from a microphone plug, I don't know. And now I can secure this cable here with a clamp. Well, the microphone is back to life. Position low power. And now position high power. 1, 2, 3. Up to 10 watt peak. That's okay. Now I will check the spectral purity regarding carrier suppression and SSB and measure the real output power. Now I will try to align the balance of the balanced modulator for TX. It's under this shield here we have installed, you remember. I've optimized the setting of this, the alignment of this balanced modulator for best reception. This is of course not the task of this balanced modulator. It has to be aligned for best carrier suppression and transmit mode. So I will see what happens when I readjust it for good TX. Hopefully I don't affect the RX. I've connected my spectrum analyzer and I will optimize the setting of this adjustment, the capacitor and the resistor here from this side. I've connected the output of the Multi 2000 with an attenuation of totally 30 dB. It's an attenuator, 30 dB connected to the input here, and the top line is 20 dBm. So we have on the top line 100 watts. This is 100 watts, and the next line is 10 watts. So when I take the microphone and speak into it, I nearly reach the 10 watts in mode FM. I reach it exactly 10 watts, but we are talking about single sideband, and this is a carrier, the suppressed carrier, which should be suppressed. Okay, this was a capacitor. It was set to the optimum point. Oh, interesting. Ah. It was also set to the optimum point. That means when I've set the balance of the balanced modulator for transmit for minimum influence on the RX path, it was also set for optimum transmit behavior. Well, that's okay. I'm lucky with it. The S meter is still down on the Multi 2000, no problem. So the balance in TX mode for SSB is okay. This is a small test setup for the measurement of the FM modulation. I have here a small modulation meter. It's rather an old instrument, but it still works very okay. I've compared it to the output of calibrated signal generators. It's okay. I've connected the output of the Multi 2000 via this attenuator and additional 10 dB to the input here. Set to mode FM, 15 kHz deviation. I've chosen here the narrow modulation, FM narrow. And in narrow, it should have, where is it, 5 kHz deviation. Maximum frequency deviation 5 kHz. I'm in the mode 15 kHz, so the deviation is expected here in this range, between 5 and 10. When I switch on, first the instrument looks for a signal to synchronize. It is synchronized, and now I can speak to it. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. It's a little bit, okay, not absolutely linear, but I think it's okay for this transceiver, but we have 5 kilohertz as it is specified. And now just for reference, the wide, FM wide, should be 12 kilohertz. Nobody uses it today, but I don't change it in the moment. I have no reason to do it. I've set it to 50 kilohertz, plus minus 50 kilohertz here. Again, waiting for synchronism. Okay. And now we have 12 kilohertz. This should be go up to this one here. We have 50 kilohertz. This is upper scale here. That's okay. I specified rather exactly 12 kilohertz. Measuring the output power of the Multi 2000 in mode FM. As we have seen on the screen of the spectrum analyzer, the output power is a little bit below 10 watts in the position high in FM. I'm measuring here with a 30 dB attenuation. We go to sensor zero, so what is milliwatt is in reality watt. And we can see here 8.33 watt. Milliwatt is watt. Should be 10. I've tried a little bit to tweak the alignment of the PA, but I didn't get it better. Initial setting was 5 watts, now we have 8 watts. The owner asked me for the low position. Now I go to the low position of the transceiver. The output should be approximately 3 watts, because it has a PA which is specified up to 3 watts input. We have 1.3 watt, so I will increase the power to 3 watt. There's a pot. Hope I can do it around this. Slowly, oops, leave it 2.7, 2.7, the low position, and when I go to the high position, again 8.33, go to low, 2.95, okay, and SSB is a little bit less. Unfortunately, I cannot make measurement of the peak hold. This power meter has no option for this, but I've seen on the spectrum analyzer when I go to SSB, I have the same peak as a constant carrier in FM, so it is done. I will try it in SSB mode. Okay, don't manage it really with a test position. One moment, high position, 2.6 in high position, it's not sufficient. Well, that's done. Next step is measurement of the receiver sensitivity. By the way, you may ask whether it's possible to adjust the power out meter. I didn't find any pot to do this. There's a rectifier in the output of the transmit stage. It's like here. It's B. This B is connected directly to this rectifier, which is a coupler in the output, where it goes to the antenna. And here is no trim pot. Here's a fixed resistor, 10K. And the point B is directly connected to the TDS meter, so I cannot adjust it. Sorry, I cannot adjust it. It indicates a little bit too much, nearly 10 watts actually we have 8.3 watts as we have measured it. Would be helpful, but I cannot align it and I don't want to change the schematic. And in the low power position, when we have approximately 2.6 watts, there's indicated 2.4 is indicated 6 watts. So it's indicating too much. It's not okay, but as I said, I cannot, I won't change it because it makes no sense. It is like it is, and I have to accept it. Here is a setup for the measurement of the sensitivity. First, I measure the single sideband SSB sensitivity. It is specified with an input signal of 0.3 microvolt, signal to noise ratio of 10 dB or more than 10 dB. It is specified as signal to noise and not signal plus noise to noise. We can calculate it, but in general, when we have more than 10 dB, so the effect of the noise when we have a signal is not so important. So I look for a difference of 10 dB here on this instrument. This is again my good old trusty true RMS voltmeter. I like it very much because it's true RMS. It's based on the thermocoupler and not on diodes, rectifiers and similar like this. The loudspeaker output where I've connected this instrument is terminated with 7.5 ohms. The specific impedance is 8 ohms, so 7.5 is also good for this purpose. Additionally, I can connect and disconnect an external speaker here. And we have here noise or no noise. I've set the frequency to 145.01, 10 kilohertz above, because on 045.00 there's a small birdie, and this birdie would affect the measurement. It can be can be heard in the background. Well, two steps. First, I will measure the noise without signal, such as this. Go to single sideband, and when I switch on, the generator, and I should connect the antenna. This would be a very good idea. It's late in the evening, please forgive me. This is a signal, and this signal should be 10 dB above the noise. Now I will disconnect the speaker, switch on the generator, adjust the output level of the speaker to zero. This is a signal, and when I switch off the generator, okay, then we have more than 10 dB down. So the signal to noise ratio is more than 10 dB. That's what we have here in the specification. Sensitivity for FM mode is measured in the same way. It is specified for signal to noise ratio 30 dB at 1 microvolt input. I've set my signal generator to 1 microvolt, connected here. This is a signal, 1 microvolt. And when I switch off the signal, this difference should be 30 dB. It is not specified how to measure it in detail. There's no FM deviation specified, no modulation frequency or anything else, only signal to noise 30 dB at 1 microvolt. This means everything and nothing, so I'd use this method, 1 microvolt in, and see that the noise goes down by 30 dB. Okay, I disconnect the speaker. Set the instruments to zero with noise. And when I switch on the signal generator with 1 microvolt, we have a drop here. The scale ends at minus 10, so I have to switch on additionally 2 10 dB steps, totally 20 dB, and then we have here 10 dB. I will do it. Plus 10 dB, plus 20, minus 10, okay. Plus 30, so we have one less, so we have 29 dB at 1 microvolt input. I think that's okay. And now we are at the end of this project. This transceivers made a lot of work, more than I've expected, and I have a lot of experience, but this old transceiver obviously had a lot of pre-owners, and some of these pre-owners thought they are clever and made modifications. And please guys, if you don't know what you are doing, keep your fingers off. It makes absolutely no sense. You ruin the transceiver. The rest is you have a non or badly working transceiver. Of course you can sell it on a flea market or on one of the known platforms in the internet, and you can say, yes, I don't know what the state is, how it works or not, but when I last operated it, it was fine. Yes, of course it was fine when you last operated it, but this was 20 years ago. Don't do it. I made a list what I had to do. Let me start. The PTT relays, RXTX, had bad earthing connections. They were pinched off for any reason. I assume someone tried to use this transceiver only for reception. I removed the old preamp, this guy here. Again, when you are installing a preamp, be very careful. In general, it makes no sense. Such a preamp is only a noise generator. The first mixer is overloaded by much more signals. If you need a preamp, do it at the antenna, not in the transceiver. Cleaned all relay contacts, some switches and pots. The rear side, backside was heavily damaged. There was a maybe it fell down or a hit on it or something like this. I had to reband it, added a new power cable with ground connections, replaced non-working bulbs by LEDs, repaired the loudspeaker connections. I modified the IF stage, the BFO leakage, additional shielding, reduced the amplification. As you see, the sensitivity is okay. The signal to noise ratio is not determined by the IF stages, it's determined by the first transistor, the first amplifier, and maybe the first mixer a little bit, but in general it's the first amplifier. Realigned it for best stability. Now the S meter is stable. Calibrated the FM frequency for duplex. The minus 600 kHz was off some 100 Hz. Also the microphone was bad. Measured the frequencies, power and the spectrum, especially the carrier suppression for SSB. Measured the output power, set the low output for a little bit below 3 watts, and measured the receiver sensitivity. It's okay for SSB and FM, even without internal preamp. I assume when the preamp was installed, there was a problem in the IF stages. And the guy who did this didn't realize that he has a problem in the IF stage by self-oscillation or BFO leakage. So the receiver is rather deaf. When there is a BFO leakage, of course, the AGC is affected, and for weak signals, it's a catastrophe. When you have such an effect, look for the problem in the IF stages and do not try to compensate one fault with another fault. Doesn't help. Again, then you have a bad or non-working transceiver. Well, that's it. I have to talk to the owner. It was a long work, much longer than I thought. Anyhow, it was very interesting for me. It was a nice, interesting project. I hope you also enjoyed it. Stay healthy and stay tuned. Some more projects to come.